Hello, coffee drinkers. It is 12:45 here on Friday, and I just got home. I read a comment on the vlog from today's episode from Chris Verns, whose question prompted all of what I'm going to put in today's vlog. Chris writes, I just watched the videos of you and Steve Smith and talking about his time feel, and I was wondering who are some of your favorite drummers that you've played with, as well as some of your favorite bassist / drummer rhythm sections. He suggests Mingus Richmond, Carter Williams, Lefebvre, Juliana. Okay, great question. Something I love to think about, to research, to remember, like to look into and remember all of the great rhythm sections that I've loved to listen to. Really great that you wrote this question now. It's an insanely late time to be doing this vlog, and this vlog could be like a feature length movie. And it's something I would be really interested to make, do a movie about rhythm sections. So this is gonna be condensed. I'm gonna unfortunately miss a ton of really important people because I can't squeeze them all in. But here's a very condensed list of some of my favorite rhythm sections and some of my favorite drummers that I've gotten to play with so far in my career. First up is Chris Chaney and Taylor Hawkins. Basically, Chris Chaney with anyone and Taylor Hawkins with anyone is a great rhythm section. These two together, pretty much invincible when it comes to like, just range of sound, range of style, and just unbelievably tight pocket and tight kind of unit. And I just saw a clip for the first time. This was Alanis Morissette's debut, television debut, I think. This was on Letterman, and this was with Chris and Taylor. And that's just amazing drumming, and let's speak about that bass playing. Chris is just one of my favorite guys of all time. I really want to get him in the vlog before I end the vlog, and we keep missing each other and being on the road and just being busy, but I'm really trying hard because I think he has so much to say, and I think you guys would love to listen to what Chris has to say. But what about that bass part on Alanis Morissette's Order Note? Just amazing, and how great it sounded on TV as well. That's really hard to do, to be that well in the mix, that well placed in the mix. Of course, that's down to the engineers and all the people at the studio, but that's a huge amount to do with what you put into that mixing console. And I think Chris's sound is just amazing. And him and Taylor Hawkins, one of my favorite rhythm sections of all time, for sure. Now, there are so many classic jazz rhythm sections on records that I have just worshipped for my entire career. I would have to go with, you know, some that I've listened to the most. That would be like Paul Chambers and Jimmy Cobb, for instance, or Paul Chambers and Philly Joe Jones in a big way. And then, of course, the classic Miles Quintet of the 60s with Ron Carter and Tony Williams. And then just great bass players and great drummers of that time. Max Roach. I love Leroy Vinegar, the bass player. I love Slam Stewart. I love Ray Brown. You know, Ray Brown and Ed Thigpen with the Oscar Peterson Trio was awesome. But that could be like, you know, just an entire vlog on its own, like jazz rhythm sections with acoustic bass and drums. But that's like definitely a condensed list for you guys if you're at all curious as to what I really dig listening to. And then what about some classic rhythm sections? What about Ringo Starr and Paul McCartney? Like one of the most successful, shall we say, rhythm sections of all time, and just great in so many ways as well, and like range of styles and abilities. And I watched this thing, Lars Ulrich and Dave Grohl having this conversation. Whether you're a fan of those guys or not, I think it's a great conversation, and they brought up some great things. And one of them was that Paul McCartney is actually a great drummer and plays a track on the latest Foo Fighters record. That I didn't know about Paul McCartney, but just those guys, you can kind of hear it in their sound, the range that they have and the musicality they have, that you absolutely. Absolutely, I can believe that Paul's a great drummer because he understands his place in the rhythm section so well. And then how we can't leave out Pino Palladino, and like Pino Palladino with anyone, Pino Palladino with Questlove, with Chris Dave, with Steve Jordan, and with like 500 other drummers, Jeremy Stacey, with Vinnie Colaiuta, with every single drummer on the planet, basically. Pino Palladino sounds amazing with everyone. Like my top five definitely has to include Pino Palladino. It also has to include Michelle Andeguicello, somebody I learned so much from. I've made lessons about her on my lesson site. I've talked about her in the vlog before. She's just incredible. Peace Beyond Passion and Plantation Lullabies were two huge records for me in terms of my fundamental bass playing. Check out this clip of JoJo Mayer playing with her. I don't know how many people are aware that JoJo used to play with her, but he did for a few years back in the day, around that time, like mid-90s, with Yossi Fine, great bass player from Israel. Michelle always had a bass player because she sometimes just sang or played a little keyboard. She didn't always play bass. So Yossi's an amazing bass player and sounded really great with JoJo, but Michelle and JoJo, that's definitely one of my favorite rhythm sections. And there are a couple of Chick Corea records that I totally wore out. The Chick Corea Electric Band Paint the World album, which was with Jimmy Earl on bass, really good friend of mine who now plays on the Jimmy Kimmel Show. He's the bass player in the house band on the TV show over here in the US, the Jimmy Kimmel Show, late night show. But it was Jimmy Earl and Gary Novak played drums in that band. Amazing rhythm section. Mike Miller played guitar, Eric Marienthal on saxophone, and Chick Corea. That was one iteration of the Chick Corea Electric Band, and I love that record. It was had a massive impact on my playing and on my writing and time and sound. I love the way Jimmy and Gary played together. I'll play you a little clip. This is a burning clip of them. I'm not even sure where it is, but it's pretty ridiculous and shows you kind of like that fire, that young fire that they had when they were on the road with Chick Corea. And I've since gotten to play with Gary Novak. We've done some gigs with Bob Reynolds down at the Baked Potato. He is an absolute monster. There was a time, I seem to remember being at Ronnie Scott's. He used to play with the Bob Berg Quartet with Ed Howard on bass. That's another great rhythm section. Ed Howard, the bass player, Gary Novak. And it was Dave Kokoski on piano, Bob Berg Quartet. I used to go see that band whenever they came to town. And I remember kind of being in the hang one night and Gary Novak talking about what he was doing, you know, and people asking him, like, what else do you do? And there was a time when he was playing with, like, Alanis Morissette, Chaka Khan, Chick Corea, and Bob Berg, like, all around the same time. And he was saying, like, yeah, well, I'd never tell Alanis about the Bob Berg gig, and I'd never tell Bob about this. It was just, like, amazing how he kept those things separate, but was so burning at each one of them. Like, he sounded amazing on Alanis Morissette's gig, I think, and was completely ridiculous with Chick and with Bob Berg. And the other record, Chick Corea record, like a later Chick Corea record that I really wore out, was with Gary Novak and Patitucci. John played on that record, also with Bob Berg on saxophone. That was called Time Warp. If you haven't heard that, that's really a massive album for me. Really, really huge in terms of its impact. And I used to jam to that record all the time and just play all these modal ideas and try and cop things that Chick and Bob were playing. Spent many hundreds of hours with that record alone. And here's a little clip of those guys playing live. Now, with all these clips I'm putting in today's vlog, I'm taking a real risk that the video might not end up being available in some territories. YouTube is so shitty like that. That's why the clips are so short. Go and search out these clips. Check out the people I've mentioned. Go buy their records. All the records I've mentioned are just incredible. They've had a huge impact on my playing, on my life, and on my career. I highly recommend you checking them out. Even if they're perhaps something that they're in a genre that maybe you're not totally invested in, there's some amazing music involved in all of those albums. And now let's get to some of my favorite drummers, some people I've been like so fortunate to get to play with. It's just it's hard to believe sometimes, like the amount of amazing musicians, not just drummers, but just the amount of amazing musicians in general that I've been fortunate enough to play with in my career. I get super emotional about it. I am unbelievably grateful. I can't even begin to explain that to you in words. There are no words for it. That moment when you walk up on the stage. I made a vlog about playing with Dennis Chambers, like maybe 100 vlogs ago now. It was a few months ago, but go check that out. I forget which number it is, but it was all about playing with your hero, and Dennis definitely was one of my heroes. And it's like that every time I walk out on the stage with him. You know, I'm really good friends with Jojo Mayer, and we've played a lot of different music together all over the world. I don't know, 15, almost 20 years, man, a long time. And it's still, I still get that feeling when I walk out on the stage, or I go into the studio, or even when we're hanging out, like. Worth it. You know, all the hard work is just, it's so worth it. And those moments just solidify doing the work and the love that I have for it. And I'm sure if you're in a similar position and you're really passionate about what you do, I can't recommend enough that you keep doing it. Maybe you're already there and you're playing with all those people and that's awesome, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. But if you're not and you have a goal and you're aiming towards working with certain people or playing a certain way or experiencing certain things in your life, like, you have to keep going. I cannot recommend that highly enough, because in the end, it is so worth it. All the people I've met over my career and all these amazing musicians I've got to play with, it's, I don't know, I'm really at a loss for words. I'll have to go away and think about it and come back and make another vlog and be a little more eloquent in my explanation as to what it actually means. Or maybe I won't. Maybe I'll just leave it like it is and it just not try and intellectualize it and leave it as something special. Anyway, Let's get to some of these drummers I've been so fortunate to play with. The guy, Chris Verns, who asked the question specifically about drummers and rhythm sections, had said he had been watching a Steve Smith video, or a video of me with Steve, playing with Steve Smith. That was amazing to work with Steve. He had been one of my lifelong heroes, especially Steps Ahead live in Tokyo in 1986 with Michael Brecker, Mike Stern, Daryl Jones, Mike Manieri, and Steve Smith. That was a huge record for me. Like, I had that dubbed onto a cassette tape and used to listen to that in my car driving around London and going to gigs. I can sing every note on that record. That was huge. And Steve was the drummer on that. You know, I didn't come to Steve Smith through like Journey, a little bit through Vital Information, but Vital Information I found out about after Steps Ahead. So, you know, and we all come to musicians and to music in slightly different ways. I think we have maybe favorite periods of someone's career, and then we start to like take a look back and look at the wider angle and see everything they've done. So I definitely came to Steve Smith through that Steps Ahead live in Tokyo in 1986. So to come full circle and actually play with him, and play with him with Mike Stern, so that's two guys from that record on one tour, that was amazing. And then with Mike's brother, Randy was on that tour as well, Randy Brecker. That was the quartet, me, Randy, Steve, and Stern. And Steve, I had no idea what to expect. You know, I know with Stern's music, there's a little bit kind of swinging stuff, and then there's like rock stuff and funk stuff, all kinds of different things. I had no idea what to expect, what that connection was going to be like with Steve. And we got to Italy and we met each other for the first time, really, and got on that stage at the Blue Note to rehearse that afternoon, and it was like, shum, it was instant. And it was so much, such a relief and so much fun. It was like, wow, this tour is going to be amazing. Thankfully, we've stayed in touch. We've talked about doing some more music in the future. And, you know, that was a definite, like, playing with my hero moment. Same thing, I made a whole vlog. You can go check that out. I won't talk too much about Dennis in this vlog, but playing with Dennis Chambers, especially doing it in the context of the Mike Stern Trio or the Mike Stern Band, sometimes as well with Franceschini on saxophone. You know, I'd worn out that Live in Barcelona Brecker Brothers DVD. That was from the Return of the Brecker Brothers tour, I believe. And that was with Dennis Chambers, James Genus, Mike Stern, George Whitty, and the Brecker Brothers. So to really play with Dennis and Mike Stern at the same time, huge. And just all the little nuances that I knew about their relationship that I could put myself in the middle of and not get in the way and to actually fit in, because I'd checked so much of that music out in the past. That was a massive key to the success of any performance I've had with those guys that I've idolized before and then got to play with later. I really checked out their music. Can't recommend that enough, that if you really want to play with someone, really check out their music and know exactly what's going on. You know, I got to play with Pat Metheny once, a few times in this one week, about 10 years ago, and we came to play a couple of tunes, and he was like, oh, let's play Bright Side's Life. Boom, I knew Bright Side's Life, because I checked out Metheny so much. He could have called probably any one of like 30 tunes, and I probably could have played it from top to bottom. So if you have a hero, if you idolize someone and you really want to work with them, really get inside their music and be ready. You know, prepare for that moment. You know, you might only get one chance. You definitely only get one chance to make a first impression. And if that first impression is one of complete musical encompassment, if you really have the whole essence of what that person you're working with for the first time does, and you can really be a support, and you can really be a team player, and you can make them sound better as a result of your experience and your practice and your respect and your general work for their music, that goes such a long way for that first impression to be like, wow, I want this guy around, you know, like this is exactly what I'm looking for. You want somebody to think that's exactly what I'm looking for the first time they hear you. So great to have that in the context of someone's music that you're working with. And then I'll give you a quick other list. Like, so there are so many drummers. I know I'm going to leave some out. Clarence Penn, ridiculously great drummer from Detroit, lives in New York, worked with him in a bunch of different settings, recordings, live shows, all kinds of stuff. Amazing, amazing drummer to play with. I say Jojo, of course, Gary Novak, Dennis Chambers, Steve Smith. Kenwood Dennard was a huge early influence, the drummer from so many different situations, but I knew him. I came to Kenwood's music and playing through the Jaco Pastorius was a VHS, you know, the instructional thing where Jerry Jamont is interviewing him, and then they play trio with a drummer and John Scofield. That drummer is Kenwood Dennard, incredible drummer and just incredible musician as well, keyboard player, singer, you name it. Had so much fun playing in his band while I was living in Boston and going to Berkeley. That was a massive early influence. And even before that, I'd play with Ayeto Morera, who was just an immense force of music. Just with playing with a pandero, like that alone, just seeing him playing a tambourine, like he can move mountains, he can move roomfuls, arenas full of people and make them dance. His music is so strong. And through that, I met Celso Alberti, another great Brazilian drummer, really with a great rock sensibility, but with that tradition of Brazilian music. He's been in the vlog, one of the earlier vlogs when I went up to San Francisco and we were hanging out. Super, super amazing cat, an amazing engineer as well. Really, really a lot of fun to be around. Super, super big fun to play with as well. And there are so many more. I, having done this now and spoken to you guys about these people. I'm like fired up, I'm excited, I'm emotional, like thinking about playing with all these people that I have. I'm grateful that I know people like Chris Chaney and that there are still things to come. Like I would love to play with Taylor Hawkins, for instance. I've been talking to Dave Weckl recently about hanging out and doing a little playing. So hopefully that will happen in the next month or so. There's still so many people to play with. I hope I can vlog about that. I hope I can make movies about that, inspire you to want to work towards that if that's something that interests you. Thank you guys for listening. This was totally random. Thank you, Chris, for the question that sparked all of today's vlog. Hopefully this vlog is viewable in all countries and me putting those little clips in of my heroes and of that great music didn't screw up the distribution of this video on YouTube. As I'm trying to sign off here, I'm remembering other great people like Mark Giuliana, just so many people. This thing could be an hour long. Maybe that's the thing I should do, is make a documentary about rhythm sections and bass players and drummers. That would be so much fun. But I'm not doing that tonight. Tonight I need to edit the vlog, get some sleep. So today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow.